All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Community College Growth Engine Fund's National Convening. We're thrilled that you're joining us today. I'm Lisa Larson. I'm head of the Community College Growth Engine Fund and your host for today's event. We look forward to sharing the experiences and the outcomes of our work over the last year with six great college systems as they took on the challenge of creating micropathways. While we know we're not going to be able to go in as much depth as we like, our team will be sharing information through our session as well as answering your questions or following up after today's session as well. So here are some tips to engage with us during today's session. We want to hear from you through the chat or the Q&A function, or join us on Twitter at #micropathways. We'll be posing a few questions for you to engage with us both on chat and on Twitter. And also, we will be taking no formal breaks today, so please take a break as you need. Today, we are elevating. We're elevating community colleges and the Growth Engine Fund's college partners, their journey, their transformations, and reflections. We're also hosting two additional days that will include our Cohort 1 and 2 colleges focusing on learner and employer engagement, and time for our Cohort 2 to begin their design process. Before we get started, I want to say a big thank you to the Labs Fund team. In addition to our colleges, their learners and partners, these individuals have supported the colleges, whether it was designing a gallery walk, running T-profile sessions with employers, meeting with presidents, interviewing learners, or countless other things. This team has answered all of those challenges and opportunities. Thank you all. If this is your first experience with Education Design Lab, thank you and welcome. A bit about the lab: we're a national nonprofit that supports college partners in designing distinct higher education and workforce models and credentials in response to the future of work and the needs and the goals of people from historically underinvested communities. This work has been informed through research and design efforts since 2013, working with over 680 colleges and universities serving new majority learners, over 230 employers, and 1,500 ecosystem stakeholders. We envision together a new learner-centered, learn-to-work paradigm that is portable, flexible, relevant, and visible for all. Our new majority learners, those individuals that have once been identified as non-traditional, you've heard that term before, are now considered new majority learners. They are in our community colleges, and these individuals are the focus of and the co-designers of the college's micropathways. They include learners of color, those who speak English as a second language, they're possibly living in poverty, are the first in their family to go to college, vets, active duty members, single parents. This is not a complete list, but these are who the fund and who our partners are committed to designing for. I am happy now to introduce Kathleen Delasky, founder and CEO of Education Design Lab, to share a bit about the fund's work over the last year. Kathleen?
Thank you so much, Lisa. Thank you so much, Lisa. I'm a little bit overwhelmed by how the reception that we're getting from all of from this first unveiling of the work over the past year of the fund and of this micro pathway movement. I think we're at this point we can call it that, because there's so many folks that are, you know, asking to be part of this and doing things on their own. And it's really exciting. I wanted to start with this slide because I wanted to start with the journey where we've come from. It was almost 2 years ago, and this is a picture of the conference. It was the summit of the League of Innovation in the Community College, and it was in Seattle. This is Dr. Rufus Glasper welcoming us and starting this prototyping session about this idea that was micropathways. And it was the very day that the first COVID outbreak happened in the US, and it was in the very city where it happened, and we were all there, and it was super distracting and unnerving. But yet the presidents that you see here, and there were about 30 of them gathered, were intent on trying to answer the questions that they were hearing from learners and employers that you see described on this slide. We've been hearing the need for shorter, flexible pathways, and employers needed more responsive partners to solve the skills gaps. And meanwhile, college enrollment was declining. Community college enrollment was declining, and this was even before the 20% decline that we've seen during COVID for first-time students. So next slide, please. We launched the fund itself. You know, it took 6 months to line up the partners and line up the funding, but the next October, we launched the fund. I used this slide when I sort of started the call to action off, that we needed to demonstrate these two proof points. And we felt that, you know, these were kind of the important things that all eyes were on us. Could we do this as a group, as a set of partners? And along the way, we actually found that there was a third proof point. And this is what's been, I think, the most exciting part, really, that as we designed new credentials and helped and worked with colleges together, we all built this innovation muscle. We learned that those new credentials could also be the gateway to broader transformation for colleges. So you'll hear about that over the next few hours, and the colleges themselves will meet together over the next 2 days to do this as well. But so I have two quick jobs to do in kicking us off. One is just to give you a snapshot of what has progressed in this first year. The groups engaged, the number of partnerships that we feel are being set up as what we call design channels in a way that is really sustainable. And then the results that we're starting to see, and this is really all the college's work. We don't take any credit for this. And we will be highlighting, you'll be hearing about the 1,200 learners that are already in the pathways. A majority of them are learners of color, which has been really exciting. That was one of the goals around new majority learners that Lisa mentioned. And so my other job is to really thank, you're gonna hear from the schools and the colleges in a minute, but I really also wanted to thank our investor partners, because some of those are here, of them are here in this early part of the convening. And really to make the point that both national funders and local funders have come together for this work, because they, like us, really want to support the experiment of, you know, can community colleges be the talent broker between new majority learners and employers in their regions as we see this, you know, sort of cataclysmic shift in workforce and the needs of employers going forward. Can community colleges be the go-to agent for that? And I think we're seeing early signs that the answer is yes. And so thank you to you, to investor partners, for helping us support that, this work. And with that, I'm turning it back to Lisa. Thank you so much for being here.
All right, thanks, Kathleen. And thank you to our funders and our partners. We are seeing a shift, and we are seeing big changes already as community colleges answering that question and being answering that response. So here's our first question, everyone. We want to engage with you. Take a look at it. Innovation is usually more successful when you build from your strengths. What existing strengths could you leverage to design micropathways? So let us know at hashtag micropathways. So we've experienced amazing impacts with Cohort 1 colleges. Kathleen just shared some of those with you, from the number of learners, employers that have engaged, to the tools and guides that were developed in support of their work, to the funding and financial support for this work, and the number of micropathways created. I'm excited to share the release of the Community College Growth Engine Fund's Design Insight Brief. Here you see the cover of that. This brief is part of the lab's Design Insights publication series, and it highlights the fund's Cohort 1 colleges, their learners, their employer partners, the micro pathway models, as well as important learning insights. The report was released yesterday and has already been reported on in Community College Daily and some other stories. They'll continue to come out over the next several days. You can find the brief on our website and through the link in the chat. So the lab and the fund use human-centered design in our approach to our work, and we pose challenge as a design question. Posted here is the fund's design accelerator question. It creates the environment to keep the focus on learners, using empathy and valuing engagement from those in our groups, in our case, learners, employers, and colleges, that are closest to the challenges that we're facing. In this case, how might we design equitable and accessible micro pathways towards high growth careers that are endorsed by employers and visible to learners? So we've talked quite a bit about the fund and Cohort One. And if you've been following this work, you may already know a lot about our Cohort One college partners. Here they are. Today, we recognize and we celebrate Seattle Colleges, the City University of New York, Prince George's Community College, Ivy Tech Community College, Austin Community College, and Pima Community College. Six of the most forward-leaning community colleges and systems in the country that said yes to leading a demonstration of how community colleges can leverage innovation capacity and regional partnerships to build employer-validated micropathways. You'll be hearing from several of them in a bit. I want to express my gratitude for their design teams, their focus and passion on learners, and their successes in creating learner-focused pathways. Well done. So you might be asking or wondering, what exactly is a micropathway? Well, it's a new class of credential, more aligned to market needs and responsive to the learner needs than, say, the traditional credentials that we're used to seeing in higher education. Important to understanding the micropathways are the design criteria that ensure the pathway success. These criteria have continued to be validated through Cohort One pathways, and they include two or more stackable portable credentials that are aligned to the regional labor market needs. They're supported and they're validated by employers. They can be completed in a year or less. They're offered in flexible delivery formats. They're affordable, discoverable, and they include 21st century skills along with the technical skills. You will see the design criteria highlighted in our Design by Transformation session with our college partners shortly after this, later in the day. So I mentioned 21st century skills. They are a design criteria and they're important aspects to micro pathways. Employers have shared that along with the technical skills, these 21st century skills are important to overall success. These credentials are represented across the micro pathway models. They embed them and you'll see them in the models as you have access to them. But those that have come up more than once are critical thinking, empathy, and resiliency. They're noted in several of them, while all of them have been embedded one way or another. So here's an example of one of the 30 micro pathways that our colleges created. You can see on this particular model, there are up to 5 stackable credentials available, including 21st century skills. They're validated by 3 employers and can be completed in 4 months. You'll also note that these credentials make up the micro pathway and build into occupations as well as continued learning opportunities. As a reminder, all 30 micro pathways can be found on our website, and we'll put a link in the chat as well. So we projected that the college systems would create 18 micro pathways in this first cohort. They blew the doors off of that projection and created 30 micro pathways in over 4 sectors and over 25 occupations. To date, over 20 micro pathways have launched, enrolling over 1,200 learners. So while we don't have all the micro pathways launched yet, our informal data and information indicates that about 65% of the learners are those new majority learners. They're diverse and they're active and they're thriving in these pathways. So I shared at the beginning that we're elevating our college partners, and we've spent the last few minutes sharing our work over the last year. I want to pivot, and we're going to now introduce the fund's Cohort 2. We're so excited to welcome 4 community college systems totaling 13 colleges. Please help me welcome Bunker Hill Community College, Community College of Philadelphia, 7 colleges within the Colorado Community College System, and 4 colleges within the Maricopa Community College District. They're launching their design work this week, and we couldn't be more excited. They'll engage and collaborate with Cohort 1 colleges today and tomorrow as they prepare for their design journey. So welcome to Cohort 2. Cohort 2 colleges are going to be continuing the work and the journey along with Cohort 1. We have witnessed the impact this project has had in a short time and believe that these pathways serve as a gateway for community colleges transformation. From the stackable program design model that engages employers and focuses on new majority learners, the colleges are breaking down the barriers of embracing new models that include both a non-credit and credit experience in one experience, or they can translate that non-credit to credit. And as important, they're creating models for colleges to collect and have critical data when they need it and how they need it to make important decisions on better serving their learners. That is true transformation. So let's hear from our colleges, our funder, an employer, to discuss the importance of creating this new class of credential. Joining the conversation today is Dr. Sean Penn, Chancellor of Seattle Colleges, Carolynn Lee, Program Officer of Ascendium, and Courtenay Gebhardt, founder of Blue Sound Construction. Help me welcome and thank each of these individuals for being with us today. You're each an important voice in this work and bring incredible perspective of this journey. So Dr. Penn, I'd like to begin with you today. Can you speak briefly about why you decided to engage in this work?
Thank you, Lisa. Good morning. You know, the pandemic hit United States so impactfully. In Seattle, we see thousands of people in the first 4 months, 6 months, greatly impacted. They lost a job. They don't know what to do. We need innovative models to address the cycle of poverty that already existed in Seattle area. And particularly this disproportionate impact on the communities of color. You know, Seattle is one of the wealthy city, technologically very advanced. However, the inequity in annual incomes has been bothering us for a long while. For example, you know, the white family average annual income is about 100,000. Well, when it comes to Latinos, 64,000, less than 40,000 for Black residents. So we have to find a way to provide rapid credential, flexible modalities, and giving the folks living wages to be able to survive. It's part of our mission. So when we were contacted by the lab, we saw this is opportunity to be a solution to our regional problem, to be part of this innovation, taking risks, and also very importantly, to work hand in hand with our business partners in the community to solve the problem. It's a great opportunity to learn, so we jumped at this opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Penn, so much for that. Carolynn, I'm gonna move to you. Why is this work important to support?
Hey, Lisa, thank you so much for the question and for the invitation to be a part of the discussion today and this exciting event. Briefly, just want to say, if anyone isn't familiar with Ascendium Education Group, in addition to being a federal student loan guarantor, a nonprofit organization, and a provider of services and tools to post-secondary institutions, Ascendium is a robust and growing national education philanthropy. And our philanthropy is premised on the idea that post-secondary education and training are the keys to unlocking a lifetime of opportunity for learners from low-income backgrounds, which is who we care most about serving. I lead one of our four grant-making portfolios under that mission, which is focused on streamlining transitions along the post-secondary journey, including diverse and alternative pathways into the post-secondary space, moving between and among education and training providers, and the transition into the workforce. I'm particularly concerned with ensuring that socioeconomic status is no longer a predictor of educational and career trajectory. And I hope that the grant making that I contribute to at Ascendium leads to a couple of key outcomes, including that learners from low income and other marginalized backgrounds are not tracked into low opportunity education and occupational pathways or dead ends, and that any new flexible, rapid, responsive credential and training opportunities that are developed to meet the needs of diverse learners are meaningful and valuable and reliable options for family sustaining futures. So ensuring that that reality comes to be means that we invest in projects like the Community College Growth Engine Fund, because it is focused on industry validated credentials, community college leadership, and data infrastructure, importantly, to really ensure that outcomes for marginalized learners and workers are clearly understood. And it really helps to provide those, as you said, affordable, flexible pathways to both additional education and realistic career opportunities. And then specifically within the streamlining transitions portfolio, the fund aligns closely with our interest to spur innovation in what some may call non-traditional pathways into socioeconomic mobility, but still grounded in post-secondary education and training as the lever of change, while providing the runway for colleges and employers to collaborate in real time in order to meet the urgent needs of today's learners and communities.
Excellent. Thank you, Carolynn. We're going to come back to you. I'm going to move on to Courtenay. So Courtenay, you're an employer. Talk to us about how is the micropathway important to your business's success and helping those individuals get into great occupations and great careers?
Yeah, so I come from residential construction. My husband and I have a small remodeling firm. We have 18 employees. We've struggled for 10 years to find people who actually have the skills that we need to do our work. And simultaneously, a lot of people come to the trades because it is a very fast on-ramp to good wages and doesn't require a lot of education to enter. But then a lot of people just get stuck because no one has time to train, no one has time to really stop and enable people to advance into leadership roles. And we desperately need some of those leadership roles, people who can run the job site. So for us, this met two needs, which was one, existing employees that actually really fall under the demographic you guys are describing, but we would love to be able to make sure that they're advancing in their career path, but they just need some of that framework of, formalized education about what it takes to put the home together. And then secondly, to open the gateway, I think, construction, you really can advance very far, but it does require some fundamental knowledge about how a building goes together. And so developing this residential construction pathway provides a format where people could advance, all the way to business ownership or to project management, but really instills kind of that foundational skills needed to be able to do that.
Excellent. And I'm going to have a follow-up to that, Courtenay, and I so appreciate your thought process to that of not only really creating the opportunity for people to gain skills, but to continue to learn in advance with you and along with you. But what was your experience in co-designing these micro pathways with the college?
It was great. We had a fantastic team. Anna Baldwin was kind of the project manager from the college side. But she just really trusted the expertise that we were bringing as industry. And so, everything from kind of determining what the curriculum would be, it just made it, we started talking in January and we had 20 people enrolled by the fall. So just having that cooperation of really being open to new ideas, it's just blown our wildest dreams of being able to create something like this very quickly. And for employers, we had a very successful job fair. I think it kind of came at a pivotal time. So having that willingness to just really listen to industry and go with it was pretty impressive.
Awesome. Thank you, Courtenay. So Dr. Penn, can you talk a little bit about how this has impacted this work of the pathways and with your employer partners and around your learners in this co-design effort? What are some of the impacts it's had on your learners and the college itself?
Well, Courtenay's testimony really says a great deal. We see the micro pathway is a highly visible example of innovative, what I say, equity-driven practices for our institution. We really so fortunate have the opportunity to what I call evangelize this model in partnership with the City of Economic Development. They provide funding this year. Community-based organizations, Seattle Jobs Initiative, Seattle Housing Authority, they have been instrumental. Our local statewide employers, such as Seattle's Children's Hospital, the Washington Healthcare Information Management System Society, the Building Industry Association of Washington. You see the broad spectrum industry see us working with them hand in hand to find a solution and tap into incumbent workers, provide scholarships. The impact has been just so tremendous, not only for the students, it's for us to be a solution to the worker shortage, but also really helping people to see there's a hope. It cannot be just despair in this pandemic. There's a ways, give them confidence, give them pathways to lead into jobs, as well as eventual credentials that can prepare them for gainful employment in this very pricey city we live in. So I can't say enough, we've been so fortunate to have employers like Courtenay throughout the region to be willing partners and willing to experiment with us. We learned a great deal.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Penn. And some comments I heard in this last statement that I think are so important to highlight and to focus on are, you said, one, to take away that there's more than despair during this time, but also the idea that learners are building not only competence in their skills, but confidence in the fact that they're able to continue on. They have a lifelong learning aspect now. They have a support team and they have a vision for where it's going. So thank you for leading that at your institution and bringing that forward. Carolynn, as you hear these comments from both Courtenay and Dr. Penn, how is this sitting with you? How does this align with Ascendium's priorities from what we've seen in Cohort 1?
I think it's so crucial what I think both my colleagues have shared, which is that this work is centered on the lived experiences of the learners that it proposes to enroll. And the needs that they have both for their education and their career. I think redesigning educational pathways and systems must be focused on the needs of those that traditional higher education hasn't served, the new majority, as we refer to them today, low-income adult learners, particularly learners of color, first-generation students, et cetera. Ascendium support specifically of the new college systems in Colorado and Arizona, Maricopa, reflects our strong interest in understanding if and how this work can be accelerated and sustained by engaging those system offices, the system-wide support and policies. And I'm so excited about the way that the new Cohort 2 college systems will be able to learn from the experiences of Cohort 1, in particular, Dr. Penn's system work, for example. We really look to levers of change like college systems in our philanthropy that can serve as both multipliers and codifiers of effective efforts to respond to the needs of learners from low-income backgrounds. We're very interested in the ways that college systems will measure the impact of this work on their learners and make decisions about scaling and even sustaining the most effective practices that emerge. Mm-hmm. And finally, I guess I would just say that we're also excited about the opportunity to support community college innovation in both form and function while leveraging the expertise of the lab and the dedicated practitioners, specifically again with our support in Colorado and Arizona, who have recognized that this opportunity to rethink how they empower working adults with credentials to support continued education and career goals. We really see the work of the Community College Growth Engine Fund as a key strategy to increase opportunity for learners from low-income backgrounds.
Excellent. Thank you, Carolynn. So appreciate that. And appreciate your support for Cohort 2 colleges, and they're excited to get their work underway and continue to learn from these experiences from these leader colleges. So Courtenay, let's talk a little bit about how this experience, how co-designing, how thinking about higher education and employer engagement differently, how has this impacted your view of higher education or partnerships within higher education from an employer standpoint?
Yeah, I mean, I think about it from two perspectives. One is specifically our employees who maybe have not had any contact with higher education, you know, and maybe weren't that interested in high school when they were even in it. It's been interesting how, as we've sponsored some of our employees to engage in various kinds of learning, we've actually sent our employees to other kinds of trainings as well. Just the spark that it creates, we benefit from that. We benefit from creating that spark of being excited to learn, being excited to advance, and kind of reimagining what education could be for them. You know, who knows, maybe some will decide they want to become architects or pursue further pathways. So I'm excited for them from just a personal standpoint, but as an employer engaged in it, for us, you know, it's just an opportunity to actually get more productive. And so I don't know if I'm answering the question well, I might need you to restate it, but designing it was incredibly easy. We just basically lifted the Home Building Institute's curriculum to turn it into a year-long program. And, you know, then the college hired the instructor. They involved employers in determining who those instructors would be. And so it has been a bit experimental. I've been checking in with the instructor on how it's going, but even he is being very innovative. He runs a multifamily, or he's part of a multifamily building complex. So when they need to do things like, hey, we're going to train on how to install doors today, he's looking for opportunities to bring them, you know, into his workplace to show an actual facility where those things are going on. So I think it's just really exciting how willing Seattle Colleges has been to experiment.
Yeah, I think that's, you had some really critical points to bring forward there. And the first is that the design process made it easy for you to engage, and also made it easy to say, let's think about this differently. And let's pull in the people that are closest to that to really put in the right competencies, the right curriculum at the right time, and have it be something that the learners are going to be able to engage in and be successful with. The other aspect is the instructor that you talked about, bringing those work-based experiences into the curriculum and the classroom or the training experience for those learners. That's such an important insight to keep in mind, and something that we found through our, that you'll read about in the insights brief. So thank you so much for being part of this and being part of the solution and willing to take this path with us, right? And see how it's going and see how it's going to work. So thank you so much. Dr. Penn, thinking about where we are today with Cohort 1 and your experiences in creating these micro pathways and evangelizing this model, I love that statement that you use. What has been an important takeaway for you from this experience?
Great question. A few things, I think, when we reflect this past year and a half. One is invest in employer relationship partnerships. You have to start, whether, fortunately over the years, Seattle Colleges, given our locations and programs, we have had good relations, but always continue to invest in that partnership. You know, Courtenay talked about the residential construction thriving because we focus on actively entry-level jobs for incumbent workers. They're willing to cover the cost of intuition. They provide jobs for people with or without experience. They took a risk. That is so important. Another important component or lessons learned, if I may, that is the program, we have to look at modality. It has to be flexible, allow folks, students to work during the, who are working during the day, attend classes on weekends or evenings. That is very, very important to be flexible. The other thing I mentioned earlier, in doing all of this, is knowing when a community or a country are in such a difficult challenges, community colleges have to stand up and say, how can we be a solution? So in the early part of 2021, we convened a lot of employees, business, including the city, Seattle Job Initiative. We sponsored what we called a COVID-19 strategy symposium that many folks attended. We laid out actually the challenges, a blueprint, industry by industry for these in order to help these people who are affected by COVID-19. What can business and Seattle College working together? So again, being flexible, building partnership, investing in them, be honest, be candid. And I think it's something we've learned along the way.
Wonderful. And thank you for mentioning that support beyond, say, the engaging and understanding what the program design would look like would be the support aspect, whether it's tuition support, hiring them and investing in them as they're going through this training. So that's wonderful. Courtenay, just a follow-up question. As an employer, what do you think was your biggest barrier that had to be overcome before you were willing to engage in this type of program?
Honestly, I didn't have any barriers, really. I mean, we've been searching for something like this. What ended up being invited to that economic growth symposium, because I had been hunting around at their Wood Tech Center for 2 years, kind of saying, hey, we have employees who they cannot take 5 quarters off to pursue education during the day. We absolutely love hiring the Wood Tech graduates that do, but you know, there's only so many graduates that can come out of that program. And many of our employees have been with us, you know, putting in their time for 5-10 years. What can we provide for them? So I think that's how I got the invitation to that growth symposium, which I just applaud Seattle Colleges for putting that on in partnership with so many others, because it just created an opportunity to engage in those conversations. And, you know, I think there was a lot of talk more along, sorry if I'm getting off track, but there were different kinds of construction being looked at. But, you know, I was there as a representative of residential saying we have a housing crisis. This would solve so many of these equity issues if we had carpenters available. I see this gap, you know, and so it's that listening that brought the parties together. And then for us, what was so helpful bringing in BIAW was talking about, you know, if we cover tuition, what if someone just immediately left, you know, as soon as we've paid for this programming. And so they designed it where it's a loan that then the student is working down, and it's really just a 12-month kind of quasi contract. But for the employer, it guarantees that if I invest in this training, you're gonna stay with me for a year to get that return on investment. But you know, obviously people can choose to cover the tuition themselves, but this made it a win-win for the employer and for the employee.
Yeah, I think that investment aspect is so critical for, again, to building confidence and competence. How do we really engage with these learners early on around that aspect? Thank you. So Carolynn, any thoughts as you've heard these comments today from Ascendium's viewpoint and from really what your priorities are of reaching out to those that have been underinvested in and thinking about building the competence and quality and the confidence that they have through these types of experiences?
Yeah, thank you. I'm super inspired to hear from both Courtenay and Dr. Penn about the work that's happening already, and it makes me even more excited about what Cohort 2 will be able to do learning from their examples. I will say just a couple of things that have resonated and that I'm most excited about. One is the evangelism, helping to ensure that this movement, as we referred to it earlier, isn't exclusive, but is inclusive and is really able to grow beyond even two cohorts in the future. And in order to do that, of course, I think another thing I'm really keen, and I know everyone here is keen on as well, is the impact and outcomes measurement to really in the coming year and years, be able to see the data on the impact that this has on learners, on colleges, on employers. And I'm excited in particular about some good groundwork that I know has been laid in Maricopa around data sharing and data measurement. And then also finally, just excited to call out the participation in Colorado with their community college system as well. Excited that there's a number of rural institutions involved in Colorado, which is a particular area of interest for Ascendium, being able to support rural education and workforce training. So really thrilled that there are a number of colleges participating that are rural serving and serving rural learners.
Excellent. Thanks, Carolynn. So I'm gonna switch back to just the last question for both Courtenay and Dr. Penn, what advice would you give to Cohort 2 colleges as they start this work?
Well, we are still obviously in the early stages of the pathways. We see great hopes. We learned a whole lot for the next cohort. One is, again, we talked about building relationships with business partners, with your local elected officials, including the city, is very important. In Seattle College's case, that one of a major person that is with us today, Anna Baldwin, really deserve a lot of credit, have the right individual. But it cannot be just someone like the college administration, the top level, whether it being a president or chancellor, has to provide support. Has to be there to say, we as a system want to do this. It cannot be just people who are working, of course, where someone like Anne Baldwin make all, she's just magical. But I think the leadership of the board, the leadership of the institution is truly very, very important. and then just be creative. I think Kathleen earlier use the word building the muscle for innovation. Be willing to take risks. And there are some things sometimes may not work. It's okay, because community colleges today, what we're facing is a different challenges. We have to be willing to break the traditional mold, butt in the seats for, you know, a quarter or 13, 14 weeks. There has to be a different way to support people in our community, willing to jump into where we know where we're going to land. But eventually, that our experience shows, taking risks, be willing to reach out, will lead us to good results. It's a win for the students, the employers, and our institutions.
Thank you, Dr. Penn. That is really, truly, such important words that you share around building a college, their flexibility, their agility, their ability to be successful in the future, and truly around this transformative effort that's going on to be responsive to the ever-changing needs of the workforce, our environment, the conditions that we're all going through. You've really provided us this framework to be able to move ahead, take those risks and try some things. Thank you so much for your leadership and in this work and at your institution. It means so very much. Courtenay, is there any advice you'd provide as we engage employers in Cohort 2?
I think I've touched on this, but the fact that these courses could be offered at night, you know, and the fact that the college was willing to take that risk, I really am excited if community colleges can see themselves as the conduit between these upcoming workers who can then connect with the real world jobs that are out there. I think higher education has often seemed kind of outside the loop to those of us who are out there, you know, in the hard scrabble life of small business. And honestly, there's just so much opportunity in small business. And, you know, I think being able to see what are these ways that we can shift to accommodate what the real world working environment, learning environment is for people that need connection to jobs.
Well said, Courtenay, well said. Thank you. And thank you for your work as a small business owner in the region and taking your own risk and stepping in to higher ed and helping go through those transformation processes. We wish you the very best as you continue on in this work. Please help me in thanking our panel for their time today, their sharing their experiences and their feedback to this work and how critical this work is. Thank you, Dr. Penn. Thank you, Courtenay. Thank you, Carolynn, so much. All right, it's time for another question. What obstacles might be in the way of designing micropathways? Share your thoughts in our chat or on Twitter at hashtag micropathways. I now want to introduce Bill Hughes. Bill recently joined Education Design Lab as our incoming president. He'll be taking on the role fully later this fall. Prior to joining the lab, Bill was the founder and CEO of Job Ready, formed in 2019. Ooh. In partnership with National Education Foundation, with the goal to reach the next million job seekers with world-class career skills training. Bill's previous positions included Chief Strategy Officer at Learning Objects, where he led its growth strategy, Vice President of Global Strategy and Business Development at Pearson, leading innovation, partnerships, and new ventures in post-secondary education. Over the past 25 years, Bill has held leadership positions at Sapient, Mercer, and the Cambridge Innovation Center. Bill's also served on several boards, including the Board of Trustees of Kaplan University, now Purdue University Global, Berkshire Bank, and Fine-Tune Learning. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Great panel. And thanks also for your team and the leadership that you're bringing to the Growth Engine Fund. The amazing work you all are doing and supporting the cohorts is evidenced, and I'm excited to see more evidence throughout the day. Again, I'm Bill Hughes. I am so grateful to lead the lab in the next leg of its journey. For me, the lab ties together three threads in my own professional journey. First is my passion for innovation, which has been at the heart of the work I've been doing. You said 25 years, truth be told, it's probably closer to 30. So, but I appreciate the years you've given me back there, Lisa. But that innovation work that I've done really helped me understand a lot about how to manage the risk-taking that Dr. Penn was talking about that you need to do to innovate. The second thread is my appreciation for human-centered design. When I was at Sapient, we were leaders in human-centered design, bringing that to the web. And I got a chance there to see its ability to yield transformative solutions. And those are the kind of solutions we need today. And the third thread is around my enthusiasm to take on the challenge of connecting the dots at the intersection of learning and work. In leading the lab, my focus now is on enabling the sector to scale, but to scale in an equity-centered way through these kinds of pathways that we're going to talk about. And also in measuring and validating innovative solutions. I believe there's going to be a flight to quality. There's a lot of stuff out there, a lot of choices for people to make. They're not always sure what to do. Do I do a course on YouTube? Do I go to get a degree? What's in the middle there? But what's really exciting about the micro pathways that are being developed here is not only that they are options, but they are being tested for effectiveness. And that's going to be really, really important in the future. Dr. Penn, Carolynn, Courtenay, thank you so much for your contributions. I appreciate all your comments. In particular, you know, I took some notes on a few things. Dr. Penn, my mother's family is from Seattle, and my cousin worked at Boeing, and he was allowed to have the kind of life that you're talking about aspiring to have for people to have again in Seattle. And it was because Boeing really was offering this kind of skill training and development and cultivating workforce. With 21st century workforce, we need to see more of that. And that's going to bring greater hope to lots of communities, including those in Seattle. I really appreciated, Carolynn, your comment on family sustaining futures. We definitely see that as an important part of the quality mix of the micro pathways that are being developed. And Courtenay, I really appreciate your courage in being a family-owned business. And I know in construction, there's so much work that needs to be done, so hard to find time to train. But your vision to be able to invest in the connective tissue and the muscle, not only for your business, but for your sector, I think it's really appreciative. And I also liked the comments that you brought about the responsiveness of the program to listen to the voice of the customer, which if you're going to do innovation is an essential ingredient. My next job is to introduce the next speaker in the next session on transformation. I want to introduce Dr. Sarah Lundquist. Sarah was an employee for 39 years of Santa Ana College, a community college serving 25,000 credit and 18,000 non-credit students in Southern California, where she served as vice president of student services and led Santa Ana Partnership, a K-12 and higher ed collaborative with local community and civic leaders, as well as parents and business representatives. She co-led systemic reform initiatives at the college that resulted in the creation of fully funded pathways from K-12 to the BA regionally through CSU Fullerton and UC Irvine. She led the student equity work at the college as well, founded its first dedicated research department whose reports drove an equity-centered revolution in developmental education encompassing English, math, and ESL pathways. She was hired by Lumina Foundation in 2017 to help launch its Talent Hubs initiative, where she supported foundation leaders in 26 regions across the US, including CUNY, with whom she's doing work now with the lab. She helped design and launch a national learning community of expert practitioners and stakeholders dedicated to increasing college attainment and closing equity gaps. For the past year, as a part of the lab's Growth Engine Fund, she has helped college teams build on their substantive foundation of equity-centered learning innovations in order to build micropathways to high-demand middle-wage jobs. In 2011, Dr. Lundquist was appointed by President Obama to the White House Commission on Education Excellence for Hispanics, where she helped to craft policy proposals for the Department of Education related to FAFSA, student loan, student financial aid, and debt forgiveness, and the structure of subsidies for MSIs. This is a position she held through the remainder of the Obama administration. Sarah received her undergraduate degree at Vassar College and the University of Pennsylvania, her master's degree at the University of Laverne, and her PhD from Claremont Graduate University. She's also been an adjunct professor of higher ed history and policy at the University of California and Cal State University. She founded Lundquist Educational Strategies in 2017 and maintains offices in Santa Ana, California and Seattle, Washington. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Sarah Lundquist.
Bill, thank you so much for that extraordinary introduction. I'm thrilled to be here this afternoon with so many engaged expert colleagues from across the nation.
and know that my partner, Valerie Taylor, and I have had the distinct privilege of working directly with the Cohort 1 colleges, whose voices will be forthcoming momentarily, over the past 12 to 18 months, and have been thrilled to see these pathways come to life across teams of experts who have dedicated their lives to the well-being, the success of learners in their communities. And this upcoming session is going to offer a unique opportunity for us to join college leaders at sea level so that we can hear the story of how they took a specific design element baked in to the theory of change operating at the Community College Growth Engine Fund to tell you the story of how they applied it to their local context to inform the micropathway development process and how to touch college systems along the way. These design elements reflect domains of work that are mission central to the community colleges across the nation, and they've been significantly elevated by the work that is in process now and yet to be undertaken in future pathways. So to get us started, I can't wait to get to this conversation. We have seven amazing leaders that are going to speak to you today. I'd like to welcome Dr. Stacy Townsley forward. She serves as the Vice President of Adult Strategy and Statewide Partnerships at Ivy Tech Community College. And Stacy's going to focus on our first micropathway design criteria, including two or more credentials that are stackable, portable, and track towards a degree. So Stacy, we're thrilled that you're here representing the work that you have led with so many other incredible people. Please continue to launch into your thoughtful content.
Great. Thank you so much, Sarah. And so maybe by way of background, I'll share that under President Elsperman's leadership, Ivy Tech has in recent years been very strategically focused on developing stackable short-term certificates that average 18 to 30 credit hours as a way to address workforce demand and offer more of those on and off ramps for learners, right, who are seeking that job or a better job in high demand fields. As a result, the number of those credit bearing certificates we've awarded has doubled over the last 5 years and now represent nearly 70% of all the credentials that we award annually by the college. I share this because while it is significant, it is a significant trend, we recognize that some of those certificates may not be intentionally sought as a first credential, as a stepping stone, because they are embedded within a longer-term associate degree program. The Micro Pathway Initiative truly has helped us revisit, rethink, and helped us build upon this existing framework of stackable credentials and move us more towards intentional processes related to a true stackable credential culture. And one of the most noteworthy aspects of our micro pathway work has been to explore how can we better knit together our non-credit and credit offerings for a more seamless, flexible experience for the learner. As you know, or probably familiar with, non-credit courses typically are focused on preparing individuals for an industry recognized certification exam, and historically are managed by a separate functional area of the college, separate from the academic side of the house. And while most of our credit bearing certificates also have coursework to prepare learners to pass industry certification exams, the non-credit and the credit operations of the college generally have been very siloed. And also, while we've long had the ability to crosswalk non-credit training and industry certifications into our credit programming, the process for doing so has frankly been somewhat clunky and at times a challenge to navigate for the learner. So hence the challenge, the design challenge. So with the Micro Pathway Initiative, we saw an opportunity to start addressing these process gaps. And all but one of our micro pathways are new programs and include new credentials and certifications as part of those certificate programs. One of our micro pathways, our CDL Plus certificate program, starts in non-credit and concludes in credit. This program is designed to meet the high demand for truck drivers with commercial driver's licenses or CDLAs, licensure training, and then provide that on-ramp for a career in supply chain management and logistics through the completion of a certificate and then upwards to a technical certificate and then ultimately an associate degree if they choose to do so. Part of the logistics behind this is upon completion of that CDLA licensure exam, if they pass, that licensure then crosswalks into eight and counts towards eight credit hours as part of the CDL plus certificate. So it's a significant chunk of that certificate. And our three remaining micro pathways, one in smart manufacturing and digital integration, and two in IT that are focused on cloud and broadband technologies, are also developing non-credit options. But I will say, truly, we are still building the proverbial airplane. While we formally launched this spring, our goal is ultimately to provide that even greater flexibility for the learner with that initial stepping stone of that industry certification, and then the opportunity to continue with that certificate, technical certificate, and ultimately the associate degree. I will say our local campuses are absolutely committed to closing the distance between this non-credit and credit that we have often siloed in our culture. In addition to thinking about how to improve internal processes, such as the handoff and orientation of those learners coming from the non-credit side into the credit side, our campus teams are working with employers and community partners to have them serve as champions for ongoing training and education. One thing I'll share is, you know, for example, one of our pilot campuses piloting the CDL Plus program has engaged employer partners to be sponsors and to really encourage those learners who've earned their CDLA licensure to continue on, to not only, I mean, they have the opportunity to have that immediate ability to be a truck driver in a high demand field, but to continue on and to complete that full CDL plus certificate as a way to prepare them for those entry level supply chain management and logistics positions within that employer's organization. So I will say our campus teams certainly are the ones doing the heavy lift of knitting together the non-credit and the credit ecosystem that we have. Our systems office, of which I'm a part, has sought to support those campuses. There are a couple ways that we'll share here. We've developed a toolkit. It's pretty basic. I mean, it's on our Google Drive, but it includes all of the marketing materials. It includes the different talking points and other things that we have developed at the systems office. And then the campuses are really driving a lot of their unique partnerships and the ways that they're doing outreach and working with the learners. Another way the systems office is helping our campuses is that we, in partnership with our CCGEF colleagues, we put forward different workshops to walk through and brainstorm the whole learner journey for these micro pathways, from recruitment to enrollment, orientation, all the touch points throughout, through completion and beyond. And, you know, again, sharing with you that it's still a little clunky, we're still ironing things out, but it became very apparent that there are great opportunities to make this a much more seamless experience for the learners. One insight that I'll share is that we continue to be excited about the opportunity to explore with greater intentionality that non-credit and credit connection. But our expectations for quick change, especially within a large statewide organization such as Ivy Tech, are tempered by the recognition of the fact that, you know, frankly, transformation and integration of previously siloed functions takes time. And so we are excited to share our learning as we move forward. And thank you for the opportunity today to share what we have done so far.
Stacy, thank you so much. I love the way you called out the chasm and then aligned the assets that are bridging it. That was a powerful way, and I deeply appreciated your authenticity. Everything is a little bit funky. That's part of the mentality of striving for something better, and a credit to your system for the risks that it's taking presently to change the trajectory of student success, as strong as it has been. What set of amendments to a longer panel? I'm very grateful. One of our experts from CUNY to speak to us next. Hannah Weinstock is the Senior Director of Workforce Development at LaGuardia Community College. She is a veteran innovator, and she's going to tell us more about the ways in which micro pathways are structured to lead to median wage occupations in a program. And she rides herd over an enormous group of innovative non-credit projects and has added energy and insights at every juncture to the work in progress. We're thrilled to have you, Hannah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sarah. And I want to really thank Education Design Lab, and especially Sarah, who's been working with us day in and day out to design our pathways and, you know, to make sure we're successful on this journey. So thank you very much to you. I'm going to talk a little bit about work-based learning as one of the critical components of our pathways. And I'm going to look at our community health worker pathway, as well as our data analytics pathway. You know, here in workforce development, we're always talking about bridging the skills gap. But when you really go and talk to employers, a lot of times what you'll find is what they're talking about a skills gap, but they're also talking about an experience gap. They say, oh, we can't find people, medical assistants, community health workers, whatever it is. But yet they require 2 years experience, 1 year experience, right? How are the new grads looking for jobs? They can't get into those positions. So we find that it's not just a skills gap, it's an experience gap. And that as workforce development providers, we have to get involved in work-based learning and to integrate that into our programs. There's many different types of work-based learning. We have everything from, you know, field trips and career panels, to applied projects where the company provides a project the students to work on, that they work on and then present back to the company, to internships and even apprenticeships. So there's quite a range. And we find that the students, this is what the students need too, because people learn by doing, right? So when we were meeting with the businesses for our data analytics track, yes, they wanted folks to learn SQL, Python, and Tableau to be able to do coding. But what they wanted more than that was someone who can take a business problem, you know, break it down, use the tools to solve it, and present something useful back. So it was really the application of those tools that they were most interested in. And even the same in our community health worker track. While they wanted our students to understand common chronic diseases and a population health approach, what they really wanted was someone who can go out and talk to and coach folks in the community to get on board with a care plan, right? Or to come into care when they've been out of care for many different factors, social factors. And so we really looked at a different approach in each track. In our data analytics track, we used applied projects that employer partners provided to us. So the students take several different, they take data analytics foundations, they take a SQL class, they take a Python class and a Tableau class. In each one of those classes, they have a mini project that an employer has provided of a problem that they want analyzed with a certain data set. And then the students then are using the tools to analyze the data and to present that back to leaders within the company. Within community health worker, we have an internship in which the students go out. They're going out and doing engagement in the community, oftentimes about vaccines or testing at this point in time, but also coaching folks on diabetes management, asthma management, all sorts of other chronic disease management programs. So we found that the work-based learning had a big impact on their ability to get hired. and to smooth that transition to employment. And I will say, especially in programs where there isn't as much of a national industry recognized credential, which is the case in these two programs, that work-based learning and doing it in a way that is standardized, that the employers can recognize the competencies was really critical. About half of the community health worker students got hired by their internships. In data analytics, our first cohorts were actually with incumbent workers who were looking to move up into data analytics positions. About half of them were promoted. And we find that to be very closely linked with how they did with their applied work-based learning experiences. Even those that didn't get hired by their internship site, the fact that they'd been through an internship and had a skills checklist where another employer had signed off that they had accomplished these particular competencies, that was very valuable to other employers when they were interviewing them, considering them for hire. Mm-hmm. And we found even that the internship sites, now that they knew what the program was, now that they knew what the competencies were, even if they didn't hire their intern or their intern decided something else, they were comfortable hiring an intern who was somewhere else because now they really knew the program, they knew the competencies. So we found it to be very beneficial. I will say that, work-based learning it's so beneficial, but it takes time, it takes resources, right? It's challenging. I mean, we should be having work-based learning in every program, but do we have the infrastructure for that? Do we have the resources for that? In my opinion, we have to find a way to do it because it's worth it. It may be an investment, but you're getting out so much more by making that investment. We've been working at the college on building out the infrastructure to integrate work-based learning into all of our programs at one level or another, or at multiple levels, applied projects and internship, doesn't have to be just one. So we've been fundraising for industry engagement, internship coordination staff, where we've gotten some grants to support that at a broader level, as well as raising money from individual donors for internship stipends. So we're really trying to take the learning from Ed Design Lab and broaden it out to that systems change level to be able to bridge that experience gap and really have that very smooth transition to the workplace for our students. And of course, yes, for the employers who get get talent that is ready for the workplace and is able to be valuable from day one.
Hannah, thank you so much. I love the way that you called out the incomplete journey of the learner acquiring the technical skills, but the employer's hunger to know those skills are not just possessed, they are ready to be applied. And the person, the learner, the future employee, or the current employee seeking a promotion has the ability to connect the dots and translate that entire package into a value proposition for an employer. I was also very impressed with the way you stretched and redefined what related experience means for job applicants. And you are now baking that related experience, mapping it backwards into critical junctures in the program, so that your learners will have the ability to articulate not just what they learned, but what they know and can do and have proven in real world settings. So that's a high bar. And I love the humble way you talked about it, pushing up against how the system is structured now, and the kinds of resources that are needed to ensure every learner who could benefit will have the opportunity for this asset to be baked into their learning experience. So I really appreciate that compelling set of ideas. As we hold on to the implications of that, let's continue the conversation and bring another CUNY leader forward from Kingsborough Community College. Jessica Sinelli is the Workforce Development Grant Specialist there, and she is going to cover something that everybody has referenced so far. She's going to talk about how the micro pathways are employer initiated and validated. Again and again, we come back to the off-ramp, the uptake, the ultimate transformation in the work life of the learner, in the economic vitality of the region. We're so glad that you're here, Jessica, and we look forward to your insights about employer relationship development. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sarah. So I'll start out saying I'm recovering from a bad case of COVID from last week. So hopefully my voice doesn't disappear on me. Just forewarned for that. So I'm from Kingsborough Community College, one of the seven community colleges of CUNY. We're located in Brooklyn at the southern tip of the borough near Coney Island. So the workforce development arm of the college was created in 2007 when we were awarded a grant from the Department of Labor for a hospitality and food service training program. Since then, we've developed training programs in healthcare, IT, digital design, maritime technology, offshore wind, and others. Now we're part of a larger division that includes the Office of Continuing Education, Strategic Partnerships, and Career Services. Our combined efforts allows us to leverage and strengthen employer partnerships across the college. So for this project with EDL, we developed a user experience design micro-credential. UX at Kingsborough was created in 2016 as part of a tech-focused CUNY consortium called CUNY TechWorks. UX is an approach to consumer engagement that uses psychology, human-centered design, and visual design to enhance how a person responds to a product or a website. We chose this because it was, and still is, an up-and-coming job title, one that's needed across industries, not just tech, and has high earning and growth potential. Because this was created over 5 years ago, we knew that things needed to be updated. So in 2021, we met with some of our backbone employers with the goal of updating and validating our curriculum to include new roles of UX designers. In addition to updating our technical skills and creating more client-centered projects, it was suggested that we put a strategic focus on soft skills. And this is where T-profiling comes in. So I've been told that EDL will talk more in depth about T-profiling tomorrow, so I'll just give a very brief description. Using EDL's definition, a T-profile is a visual construct of a T-shaped learner that highlights the technical skills needed for a specific job and the 21st century skills needed to thrive in today's workforce. EDL has identified 8 skills, including initiative, resilience, intercultural fluency, oral communication, collaboration, creative problem solving, empathy, and creative thinking. Visualizing what a T profile looks like, the 21st century skills are at the top of the T and the technical skills are at the stem. Mm-hmm. So how does a T profile work? For us, it's an interactive tool and activity, which involves a facilitator leading a group of employers and often an instructor, curriculum designer, or other program administrators. You start by reviewing a specific job description and then methodically break it down to the component skills. For this project specifically, we are focusing on 21st century skills. We asked our employers to select the top three competencies, the top three 21st century skill competencies, and then break them down in order of importance. So I found three takeaways while doing this project. Number one, it's very specific to the job title and the employer and the training curriculum. The employer that we worked with to develop this micro-credential was also one of our instructors. Through our process, he chose intercultural fluency as the primary competency, focusing specifically on recognizing and challenging cultural biases, incorporating diverse perspectives, showing curiosity, and demonstrating self-awareness. So in his case, he was looking at the needs of the job title and how they can be taught rather than the deficiencies of new employees. I did T profiles with two other employers who came at it from different perspectives. One of the employers profiled a junior research designer. this gentleman had a track record of hiring people who were new to the industry and needed a little bit more guidance with their professionalism. The other person was a hiring consultant who focused oftentimes on UX-related careers and was specifically looking for, or we were profiling a UX developer and researcher for a small startup. She's always had trouble finding people who are skilled in creative problem solving and had trouble defending their ideas. So these two, oddly enough, neither of them chose the intercultural fluency, I think, from the different perspectives that they were looking at it. These last two employers I mentioned, this is more just to gather more information about the industry, not necessarily to change the 21st century skill we created for our micro-credential. The second takeaway I have from this is that it's really a conversational tool. While the intention was to identify a 21st century skill, I saw it as a really great way to engage both employers and faculty about the industry and our curriculum. It gave us structure with a specific focus, while also providing ways to branch off into other related topics. I did this with one of our healthcare programs. The faculty member was really surprised by how much the job responsibilities of care coordinators had changed since the curriculum was first developed. It had been years since he had spoken with that employer, so he wasn't aware of the day-to-day responsibilities. I think he went back to his team to revise certain components of it based on this information. So takeaway number three, you need to be flexible and agile, and sometimes you need to go off script. Some of the people really struggled with the ranking. They noticed the crossover between competencies and had trouble selecting just three. It's interesting seeing that that was kind of a stopper for them. People also came in with their own definitions of the 21st century skills. It was really helpful on our part to talk through the skills from a workforce development perspective, not just as an employer. One thing that was really important was be ready for skepticism and know how to work with it. I had one employer who almost immediately poo-pooed the project, saying that if we really wanted to help diversify the industry, we really needed to focus primarily on the technical skills so students could compete for the jobs they were looking for. But then he spent the next hour talking about the soft skills that new employees lacked. So he really wasn't interested in engaging in the T profiling at first, but he obviously had some really important information to share with us. So from all of this T profiling, we saw that employers had a lot to say and they were really eager to engage in more conversations. From there, we developed the Tech Advisory Board, launched in March 2021. It's a group of seven employers who really wanted to engage with conversations around our training programs. When I gave them a really brief overview of our T profiling, a few of them expressed interest in doing more with me so they could help inform curriculum development. So moving ahead, we plan to use these T profiles when developing new programs. A few months ago, when a director at a local home care agency reached out to us about hiring some of our students for our home health aid program students. Later this month, I'm going to be doing a T profile with her so we can talk about what needs to be added into our curriculum to ensure that our students succeed while on the job. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jessica. That was a very interesting dive into the T profile process. Several of your points I thought were very critical. The first is don't assume that this is a familiar territory for employers. This is a very different way than institutions and higher ed discipline experts may have interacted historically with employers. It opens up a very dynamic new space to identify the 21st century skills, but in the process, validate and refresh the technical skills. I love the multiple tracks that you very elegantly and suggestively wove into your description, and that it is touching the system by developing a new protocol, a new standard of real-time connection to validate what the curriculum is and to keep that validation live and in the air in conversations. And perhaps what I took away most of all, although I loved all of your points, was the spontaneous combustion that happens when a faculty member and an employer and a college leader get together to really take stock of the shared stakes that they have in a successful and vibrant talent pipeline. And so I really appreciated the way you encourage your colleagues to circle back, not make assumptions that people understand what the conversation will encompass, and how many very different doors there are to the room that you ended up in and have now memorialized as an ongoing tech forum for educators and employers. So thank you for all of those insights. I'm certainly still processing them myself, and as I do so, I'm excited to transition to Dr. Ian Roark, who's the Vice President of Workforce Development and Strategic Partnerships at Pima Community College. And Ian is going to bring to us something that everyone has in their head and their heart, a strong learner focus to the design criteria that encourages multiple approaches to thinking about micro pathways, how they can be completed in 1 year or less, the flexible delivery format you heard about earlier, and accessible because they are affordable. We're excited to hear more about the work at Pima, Ian, and thrilled to have you with us on the panel today.
Sarah, thank you very much. And it's an honor and a pleasure to represent Pima Community College today as part of this national convening for the Community College Growth Engine Fund. Really, this quote at the top speaks to how we at Pima have approached what we really see as an artificial distinction between credit and non-credit in the long term. And that is, how do we re-innovate and reorient our business model around the learner of today, the new majority learner? We have learned so much through this experience and really agree with much of what we have heard today regarding T profiles, the skills, the employer relationships. But at Pima Community College, we've embraced what we call a one and done philosophy, meaning that we know that students are going to need to return to our institution throughout their entire career in order to upskill and reskill due to the challenges that we are facing with respect to automation in the workplace and demographic change, meaning people are working longer and longer and longer in their career. So what we have learned is that we really needed to co-enroll most of our enrollees through the public workforce system. And that's really what the first bullet speaks to. But with universal access and universal design, we know that universal design means many different things with respect to curriculum. But for us, it was designing micro pathways not as a distinct non-credit offering versus a for-credit offering versus a hybrid version of a course versus a face-to-face version of a course. In working with deans, faculty, and our partners in Pima Online, we came up with a universal design process where we take the very competencies and skills that are embedded in the micro pathways and design around all of those different modalities at the same time, so that when we launch the micro pathways in whichever modality we need to or that our learners need, we are prepared to do so with a single design process. Universal access speaks to the purposeful launching of every single micro pathway in a non-credit format. Our goal was to make the barriers to entry into our micro pathways to be as minimal as possible, to where it was only the price point, and then be transparent about what that price point was. Even still, the learners that we were prioritizing and serving, those that are displaced by the pandemic, those that are in low-wage jobs now, working adults, we wanted to work with our public workforce system, which we call Arizona at Work Pima County in Southern Arizona, to co-enroll all of our participants in our micro pathways for WIOA funding in addition to generous scholarship funding, thanks to our partners at Bank of America through our Bank of America Jobs Initiative, who have supported this work at Pima. Each one of our learners in a micro pathway, though they may be in a non-credit version of a course, we do not refer to them as non-credit students or non-credit learners any longer at Pima Community College. A learner is a learner is a learner, and they are all deserving of the same level of support and service, whether they choose a not-for-credit option versus a for-credit option. So therefore, each one of our learners who are enrolled in our non-credit versions of micro pathways are supported with corporate and community navigators who provide frontline student affairs service and support to every single learner in their journey in their 8 to 12 weeks micro pathway. In addition, many of our learners are not in a cohort together. They are embedded within for-credit labs as well. So in some cases, we have a learner who selected a non-credit option in the same open lab as a learner who has selected a for-credit option of the very same micro pathway. And finally, all of our micro pathways that we've launched at Pima, of which there are 8, are fully stackable into a certificate and/or degree program through prior learning assessment. And we are upfront about how many credits that each learner is potentially earning in escrow through the purposeful non-credit variant of the micro pathway. Finally, back up to the quote at the top. We know that the distinction between for-credit and non-credit exists because of accreditation, because of federal policy and longstanding structures. However, we at Pima are willing to innovate to challenge that artificial distinction from the context of a competency-based world and the learners who need the skills here and now for upward mobility and removing as many of those barriers as possible. So we really are looking at our work with micro pathways, not only as an end in an excellent program that learners need here and now, but a means to a new end, which is designing a future of higher education in which the learner is the fulcrum on which all other things at the institution pivot. Thank you very much, Sarah, and look forward to hearing from the rest of the panelists today.
Ian, before you go away, I'd like to probe just a little bit more deeply on this revolutionary concurrent enrollment model, where you are minimizing the credit, non-credit identity of the learner and centering instead on the pathway, the career pathway that they're participating in. This is, I can tell, designed to have a cultural impact, not just on the institution and its hierarchies of stature and power, but also to transform the agency of the learner themselves, not to be viewed, I think I'm speaking a truth to say out loud that there is a prestige hierarchy across learners, and that historically, non-credit learners have been lower prestige learners in community college systems because they've often bring less amounts of formally completed education to the table. Can you talk a little bit more about what levers you pulled to affect this change? And I'm hungry to know just a little bit more about your last bullet. When you talk about credits in escrow, again, to expose something that community colleges are not proud of, but eager to change, some learners have told me in the past that it's easier to take the course again than to cash in on the credit they've earned through prior learning. You talk about an escrow account that makes me think all I have to do is matriculate into credit to activate it, and that those units will populate on my transcript. Could you demystify this a little bit for us?
Sure. So to the last question first, Sarah, the corporate and community navigators, that is one of the processes that they will help our learners navigate. Interestingly, many of the learners have expressed an interest in the model that we have developed, and so we are actually building a second level of some micro pathways, where one micro pathway in a non-credit format may indeed stack into a second micro pathway in a for-credit and or non-credit modality, whichever one the learners choose. And of course, there's always the business model piece with respect to volume and how many learners choose which model. But that is the job, or one of the responsibilities of the corporate and community navigators, is to demystify that transference, if you will, of the credit when they seek to enroll in their certificate or degree program. to the larger picture, it takes leadership and it is a cultural change. And we're going to hear from Chancellor Lee Lambert later in this in today's convening. And without the leadership of our chancellor, without the support of our executive vice chancellor and provost, Dr. Dolores Duran Cerda, and our executive vice chancellor and president of campuses, Dr. David DeRay, we wouldn't have the support we need to challenge that existing hierarchy and that existing culture. But it's because equity is really at the center of all of this work. Everything that we do within higher education that hierarchicalizes learners and in many cases otherizes them, especially when you put non in front of a learner and call them a non-credit learner, we have otherized them. That's why we have embraced institution-wide this vision of the new majority learner that the Education Design Lab has really taught us to embrace and being about in the context of equity. Because the same systems and processes that we organize ourselves around with respect to this hierarchy perpetuate those hierarchies in society as well. And that's really what we are trying to break down with respect to how we've approached eliminating the differentiation in terms of outcomes and quality. How we do that at Pima is people generally support that which they help create. Our faculty and deans in academic areas have been central to co-creating these micro pathways. They are not imposed, they are not imported, they are designed by our own full-time faculty with support from staff through various supporting entities throughout the institution.
Oh, that's dynamite. I thank you so much. And I love the way that you have inverted traditional thinking about access to take a look at critical variables related to a learner. Could be their income level, could be their access to Pell, could be their, they might be on a journey towards permanent citizenship, but there might be a number of life factors, not their talent, not their ability to be a successful employee. And you are in a sacred trust with that learner, examining those variables and selecting an on-ramp that will give them the most benefit. So it's a very inspiring framework. And to take this very design criteria and look at it now through the lens of another college, I'm really thrilled to bring on June Evans. June Evans directs, speaking of new things, the Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship at Prince George's Community College. She's going to continue, as I mentioned, on this design criteria, but bring us all over to Prince George's Community College, where it's been very exciting to follow the work that they're leading, incredibly systemic and transformational. I have kept my fingers on the pulse of it, June, and we're very pleased to hear from you directly.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sarah. I'm glad to be here, especially amongst such esteemed colleagues. They have done such great work. It's just so great to see how everything is coming together and seeing how my colleagues at other community colleges are putting forth innovation into education. And it's just a wonderful opportunity to be a part of this initiative. Well, I'm going to start off and I'm going to talk about our approach at Prince George's Community College and the approach that we collectively as an institution decided to do was to use this opportunity to build on our Pathways Initiative. We felt that when this opportunity presented itself, we were ready and primed to take it to the next level. The college had already created pathways within our departments and divisions and in the industries. And so now, with the opportunity to look and dive a little deeper and to see how we could bridge the gap between the non-credit side and the credit side, we knew that this was the opportunity for us. And so we used this opportunity to really take a deeper dive and invest in competency-based education. And we're using this pilot program to really demonstrate how this can work using the micro pathways, micro credentials, and hopefully we can use this and be able to scale across the college. So in transitioning to competency-based education, we were looking to address some of the learners' needs that during the pandemic, one thing that we surveyed our learners because we wanted to understand what were some of their pain points. And we wanted to see that everybody had to basically transition to going online, but you know, was just going online the way to go? Was asynchronous or virtual synchronous, was that satisfactory? Or did learners need something more, something different? What did the pandemic do to education, and what did we need to, what do we need to do to address our learners' needs? So we use this as an opportunity to address the what learners said they needed more flexible options. So within our micro pathways, and we do have three, and ours are centered around healthcare, which we have our healthcare technician micro pathway, IT, which we have our IT support specialist micro pathway, and hospitality leadership our micro pathway. And so we, when we describe our micro pathways as it, as using competency-based education as the foundation, we say it is self-paced, competency-based, and learner-driven. And let's look at those three things that build, that make our micro pathways unique. So when we say self-paced, our micro pathways are online, 100% online. The clock starts when the learner is ready to start, because we have rolling admissions. So within this online platform, learners are, we're constantly enrolling learners. And when we tell them the clocks, that your 12 months start when you log in and you click start. Competency-based is because we are focused on not what you know, but how can you apply what you know? And so really looking at turning what traditional education focuses on, outcomes, changing those outcomes to competencies. And sometimes we use those words interchangeably, but when we took that deeper dive and looking to do that transition, it was not as simple as you may think, but we are able to do it. And we have successfully transitioned our outcomes to competencies in our micro pathways. And then lastly, it's learner driven. And once again, we tell the learners, this is, you start when you're ready. You have 24/7 access within the portal or in, well, our learning management system, which is Blackboard. Learners can reach out to their advisors. They can reach out to their faculty members. They can reach out to a program coordinator, and all of that is accessible within Blackboard. So we tell them, if you have struggles or if you need assistance, you can reach out to any of these individuals at any time. And we also have an overall coordinator of our micro pathways who is constantly monitoring and looking at learners as they progress through their micro pathways. So we're able to see things from a holistic perspective, and we're able to see where learners are, see how they're progressing, reach out to them at any time if it looks like they're not moving along at a, you know, at a decent pace, and we're able to quickly intervene if needed. So let's look at how we were able to get to this. And here we say step one, and the first thing we had to do was create buy-in from the college community internally, as well as buy-in from our external partners. Now, when I say buy-in, it's because sometimes, or when we were talking with the college community, especially with faculty, many times faculty members kind of saw asynchronous as equivalent to what we were trying to achieve with competency-based education, having self-paced, competency-based, and learner-driven approach. But it's much, much more than asynchronous. Literally, as a faculty member, you have to reimagine what faculty looks like in a competency-based model. Now, once we created buy-in from our faculty, and others across the college, we also had to create buy-in from our external partners. But this was done with the help of the Education Design Lab and the Community College Growth Engine Fund, because as my previous colleagues mentioned, we were able to work with our employers, in the design process, utilizing the tools that they gave us to really be able to involve our employers early, which truly helped with the external buy-in. Mm-hmm. Once we were able to do that, then we had to look at how do we provide that professional development and support for our faculty. Well, in the initial pilot program, it was done in two ways. One, we utilized our faculty to be the subject matter experts when it came to curricula design. And I say that was because we took a gradual approach, which I'll talk about in a minute, but we took up an approach where we worked with existing curricula. And so we worked with existing faculty to look at the curricula and be able to reshape it, revisit it, rethink it, and really remake it to fit competency-based education. So part of that process of using the faculty that was actually assigned to our micro pathways gave them the professional development that they needed. But when we look further down at scaling up and being able to apply this in other areas across, in other departments across the college, we know that we have to have professional development because truly it is faculty reimagining. And it's looking at reimagining how you utilize faculty because they're not there on a regular time frame of you have to be online Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, or you have to have, you know, this amount of time dedicated to your office hours. Faculty is looking at their learners from a big picture perspective through the learning management system on a regular basis, and they are expected to be responsive when learners have concerns or issues or express some concerns. Also, the professional development is looking at faculty working in conjunction with advisors and in conjunction with program managers on the non-credit side. So looking at how we provide that support to a learner holistically, it's something that faculty need to understand because it's not how they traditionally work in a traditional educational environment. And then step three was gradually converting our course modules to competency-based education so that we could work with and see the progression of over time. And when I say gradually convert, part of it was starting with something manageable, right? Starting with programs that one, already included some type of hands-on learning within their program. So already having, working with courses and programs that were used to, let me see how you can demonstrate what you know, helped us as a gradual approach. I'm also looking at curriculum that was already, you know, kind of leaning in a way that understood hands-on approach, kind of understood the foundations of competencies, and being able to convert the current curricula into a competency-based curricula. And so that, with that said, that was really the process for moving this along. And I can say it's been a rewarding journey thus far.
June, that was an incredible action-packed summary, and you have transported me to a very historic juncture in the history of your institution, and I appreciated the way you lifted up certain truths and made them self-evident. You have to have a working model, and as these working models come to life, that will dramatically accelerate the adoption of this concept within your institution because it has been the reimagination of the teaching and learning process with discipline experts fully empowered to shape that. And I love the reciprocity that is built in. It is so inherently empowering. The coordinator and the faculty are watching over the learner. the learner is easily connected to those experts depending on whether their question is content-based or resource-based. And you have your employers engaged and ready to grab that competent learner as they approach the finish line of their pathway. I want to close and bring our next panelist by thanking you for working depth of what it means to start the journey of transforming your curriculum, and they might very well be with existing programs, to something that is competency-based. You've given us a template, a formula, and glimpses to what that work looks like on the ground at Prince George Community College. I thank you for your insights. We're all hungry for more. And I want to bring up our closing panelists, two extraordinary women from from the Borough of Manhattan Community College. We have now with us today Dr. Donna McLean Grant. Donna is the Assistant Director of Workforce Development. Her partner, speaking of discipline experts, is the EMS Program Director at Borough of Manhattan Community College, Assistant Professor Megan Williams. These two women have some very exciting insights to share. The very first intersegmental micropathway that we are sharing today. And let me turn it over to them so you can hear their story firsthand. Thank you so much, both of you, for being here with us today to close out Transformation by Design. Donna, I think you're going to get us started.
I am. Thank you, Sarah, for inviting the Borough of Manhattan Community College to share information about our micropathways for high schools. You know, the EMT micropathway is an intersegmental training program that does begin in the final year of high school. Our partnership with EDL affords BMCC the opportunity to be able to enhance our standard EMT curriculum with an aim to be more focused around rising high school students. And the intentional development of work readiness soft skills that are aligned with measurable soft skill competencies in critical thinking, problem solving, and empathy with digital portable credentials, along with stackable industry EMS credentials, CPR, and up to 7 earned college credits, along with dual enrollment status into community college. This high school CTE program, for EMT projects, is actually also sponsored by the Department of Labor Strengthened Community College grant, as well as the New York City Department of Education. It's a collaborative effort between faculty led by Megan Williams, industry, ACE, as well as our support from our provost, Erin Wan, that does provide a training opportunity for in-demand jobs with healthcare career trajectory along with earned college credits. Our target audience are rising seniors from New York City Department of New York City Department of Education High School. But we've actually attracted two high schools, one called the New York City Urban Assembly School of Emergency Management, and the other one is the Union Square Academy. The program is designed with two tracks, and both tracks allows our students to be able to earn stackable credentials. The first track is called our Pre-Health Science Bridge component, which is a 3-month training and it's offered in the fall semester. It provides career awareness, college preparation, introduction to medical terminology and anatomy and physiology, along with the 21st century soft skill development curriculum in critical thinking and problem solving, where we offer 2 of our 3 micro credentials developed. Pending on this track is a credit for prior learning agreement, where we propose to offer 3 college credits for the 21st century micro-credential under our career planning course. We're also pending dual enrollment for this particular track. We actually attract 35 students to this track. Of the 35 students, we will be selecting 18 who transition into the EMT occupational training track. It's a 6-month track of 198 contact hours, where we offer the students 3 credentials in the emergency medicine certification of New York State EMT Basics, National EMT Basics, as well as CPR. The other micro-credential in empathy is also offered in this track. We do have a credit for prior learning agreement under the Department of Paramedics for the EMC 100 course, which is 4 college credits. We're happy to say at this point that we have been granted the approval for dual enrollment for our high schoolers to obtain 4 college credits for our EMC 100 course this spring. I'm going to hand over the following talk to my colleague, Megan, who will focus more on the context of how we enhanced and designed our curriculum for the micro-credentials.
Thank you very much. And that was a great summary of everything that we have been doing and where we started and why we're really excited about what's happening with this program. We started a couple of years ago before this grant with the New York State Department of Education and their CTE high school, specifically the Urban Assembly School for Emergency Management. And through that very close daily partnership, we recognized that the students were looking and needing more 21st century skills as we've come to know them as. And when this opportunity came up, this was the perfect meld of what the students needed, what they were looking for, and something to get them involved, excited, and also be able to gain something out of it as well. We found that many students, while they had the drive and they knew they wanted to do something in healthcare, once they got started, and there were so many other things they learned about being an EMT, they decided, yes, EMT is good, but I wish that we knew and could have learned some of these things and then kind of off-ramped. And this grant and this partnership does exactly that. So these students this year did the micro-credentials, as we spoke about. We discussed through T profiles to going back to our industry experts to working with former students, working with instructors, and we settled on the 3 problem solving, empathy, and critical thinking as the most important to highlight at the very beginning in this healthcare prep class. And through that, we developed with the EDL a very specific curriculum that helped the students to conceptualize exactly these micro-credentials in healthcare. So in healthcare specifically, they looked at problem solving and applying how to figure out what the concern, the medical problem, the traumatic problem that the patient is having, and apply all the steps of problem solving, look at critical thinking and doing the same. So they really took these micro-credentials and made it very specific into the field and the healthcare and medicine going forward. One of the amazing offshoots that we had hoped but didn't realize the amazing potential out of this was that not only were the students succeeding academically and being set up for success going forward in EMT and the professional side of this as well, they were transforming how they were interacting with their fellow students, with their fellow colleagues, with how they were looking at going forward into college and what colleges and where to go to college. It really just branched out from, well, we're going to prepare you with micro-credentials in this health prep class. And it just branched out to every avenue. And you could see their communication styles changing when they even wrote back an email. And it was amazingly professional and thoughtful, and they were thinking ahead of the game and thinking steps ahead, which are all skills that our employers tell us time and time again they want the students to have. So it really helped to branch out in ways that we never even thought would happen, and just an amazing blossoming of this partnership.
Well, Megan, I just want to express my appreciation to Borough of Manhattan Community College for giving the Community College Growth Engine Fund its first working prototype of contextualized to the discipline and the occupational zone 21st century skills. The design intentions were audacious. You spent hundreds of hours in the annals of EDL's archives related to the subsets of skills associated with each of these, but you took with you the certain knowledge that the more relevant and contextualized any skill is, technical or 21st century, the more deeply it will inhabit the learner and become part of who they are. And the anecdote that you shared about how it transformed so many things related to the student's agency, to the way they radiated out what they knew and could do, and even the way they engaged with others. And as we close out this panel, I want to say it was strategic positioning that Borough of Manhattan Community College went to this deeper level in the healthcare field at the time that our very nation is rethinking the skills and abilities that successful providers have to have at their fingertips. And so for seeing this opportunity, not the full scale that any of us could have imagined, but going in and empowering your learners to be ready for jobs that may not completely even exist yet because of what you've given them, and to be masters of their own career and academic future. I can't imagine closing our panel out with a more powerful call to all the work that has been accomplished and yet to be done. To you as well, Donna, and to all of our panelists, the amazing group of college leaders that have brought their work to life in all its humble, raging glory. We stand on your shoulders as we turn our heads, pivot to the future, take a look at the learners yet to be served, and scale up the models that are now active prototypes. From the bottom of my heart, I thank you. And with excitement for the closing portion of today's program, would like to invite our CEO and founder, Kathleen Delansky, back to the spotlight to take us on the rest of the journey. Kathleen?
So Sarah, one quick, before we bring Kathleen back, I would like to also echo our thanks to our speakers and our college representatives today, Ian, Hannah, Stacy, June, Jessica, Donna, and Megan. You really do represent the very best with your colleges for our new majority learners and what we're seeing so far throughout this last year. Thank you so very much. Before we move back to Kathleen to close out our session for today with our fireside chat, we have our last question. What has inspired you so far today about the potential of micropathways? Share with us your thoughts. Again, we would love to hear from you. So Kathleen, come on back, and we look forward to seeing what's next.
Can you all see me? I'm not able to start my video, so I don't know if you can. Ah, here we go. Okay, there I am. Well, thank you, everyone. I was just riveted by, I really love the way that the team has organized these talks by the design criteria. We came up with the design criteria for micropathways really by listening to the voices of over 1,000 learners over the course of the first 6 years of the lab's life, and also employers. And you know, the design criteria that you saw that were the sort of the linchpin of each of the panels were you know, sort of just jumped out at us and became pretty obvious about what needs to happen for learners to be able to engage and for employers to see value in the kinds of credentials being created. So you know, thank you for each team's elucidation of this. I also wanted to mention, we had a lot of questions in the chat over the last hour, and particularly in the first hour, about four-year institutions. You know, we're making a bet on community colleges to be a talent broker for new majority learners, but we also see a lot of evolutionary and revolutionary work going on in four-year colleges. The lab has worked, you know, worked a lot with four-year colleges and with we did an entire design challenge around seamless transfer from 2 years to 4 years. So we are very interested in how this model does apply to four-year colleges, which a lot of you were asking us in questions in the chat. And we have talked about the idea of maybe doing a four-year specific cohort. And so that is very much in the offing or a possibility. So, you know, just certainly email us and we can give you our emails if you want to be, you know, considered for that, or even just come to a discussion about the relevance and efficacy of these micro pathways and the models that we're using. But for sure, you know, let us know. The second thing that we heard a lot of is people asking about the business model. Dr. Rourke referenced business model in one of his answers. We are, and that's part of the effort to bring non-credit to the for-credit side, is for the federal financial aid models and the, you know, advising that goes with that to work, as well as obviously credit towards a degree. But these are, there's a lot to be, we'll talk in the last panel in the fireside chat a little bit about business models, because, you know, sustainable models are key here. So I think at this point, I also wanted to make a mention about Lisa, your host for the day. You know, because she started out, she didn't get properly introduced. I just wanted to mention that she joined the lab early this fall to lead the fund after seeing what we were doing and being one of our both designers in residence, as well as a community college president. She was the president of Eastern Maine, a community college, when she did a lot of work with us around micro-credentials. And she previously was the community college president at North Hennepin in Minneapolis. So she's had both urban and rural experience. And we were, you know, so lucky that she said, you know, I want my next chapter to be to be the head of the Community College Growth Engine Fund. And so it's been such a pleasure to have her here. And next, I'm excited to introduce our panel. We are calling this a fireside chat, no fire. But we'll be on fire, so hopefully that will do the job for us. I'd like to call up if everyone is here. I'll ask my team members. We have Lee Lambert here. He is the Chancellor of Pima Community College, who a lot of you know. We actually need to start with him for a couple of questions. I would say, team, you know, the others can join as they come in, because we'll hopefully have time to do some interaction. But as the others come in, by all means, let's bring them up on stage. But we know that we needed to start with Dr. Lambert because he has a meeting with the governor. Is that right, Dr. Lambert? That we had to work around
so,
here.
So Kathleen, as life may has it, the thing got rescheduled.
Okay, so maybe you can be on for the whole panel and we can be more interactive.
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes. All right, well, we'll still start with you, but I would say Emily and production team, feel free to have the others come up as they arrive. And I'll go ahead and mention them now. We have Dr. Sue Elsperman, who is the president of Ivy Tech Community College, and she joined that role after being other Sue. Hi. She has been the 50th lieutenant governor of the state of Indiana, which gives her a very good statewide perspective on transformation. And she's also been involved Ivy Tech's been involved in our single moms work, and she's been very influential in that. And then Dr. Rufus Glasper is president and CEO of the League for Innovation in the Community College. Dr. Glasper was the one in the picture. For those of you who are here at the very start of today, I flashed up the picture of our first prototyping session for micro pathways. He invited us to do that in Seattle on day one of COVID in the United States, not knowing, of course, that was going to happen. But Dr. Glasper has been such a great champion, and his organization has both helped us frame this initiative and to keep it in the context of other innovation initiatives going on in the realm of community colleges, which he and his organization have been at the helm of. So this is a very exciting group to round out our day. Okay, I'm going to start, if that's okay, with Dr. Lambert. So I wanted to ask you, you know, we've actually written an op-ed together, which we could put in the chat as well, that talks about kind of what we learned together about this, because you were a partner of the labs before this as well with some other projects. But what has been for you the most exciting and maybe even the most surprising thing about this accelerated design year for you? And how does it play into what you wanted to do anyway at PMU Community College, because you're a huge innovator, you know, before we ever showed up?
Well, first of all, Kathleen, I want to thank you and your team for asking PMU to be part of this exciting project. It's truly transformative, and it's a pleasure to be on with Sue and Rufus. I remember being there with you and Rufus and others in Seattle on that very first day that we got this unfortunate news that we're all now living through. Let me put this in probably a 30,000 foot level for a moment, because it really is illustrative of what we're doing at PMU. So Ian Morrison wrote a book back in the late 90s called The Second Curve. And for folks who are not familiar with The Second Curve, I thought I'd just read just one little passage out of there, because I think it sets the stage for why PMU and why micropathways and beyond. He's citing to Stein's law. If something is unsustainable in the long run, it will end. And the corollary is, if something is going to be a big deal in the future, it's got to start sometime. Mm-hmm. I believe our model is on an unsustainable path. I mean, you know, we've been a decade or more now of declining enrollments. Our relevancy is in question. So what more do we need to know that our first curve model is not going to get it done anymore? I'm not saying it's going away, but it's not going to get it done anymore. So we needed to really look to venture out into something. And then when you approached us and said, would you like to be part of this? I think this was an opportunity to get more onto that second curve. So mm-hmm. when you think about the second curve, the new technologies, new consumers, new geographic market opportunities, this was one of those initiatives, I think, that I think really answers that call to get on that second curve. But it isn't without risk, and it does require courage of leaders to see that. So let me, you know, just say that as a way of providing that context. So we have long known that we've been in service to the non-traditional learner. I mean, Ian talks about this, and we talk about it a lot. We're in service to what we refer to as the lost decade. People leave high school and they wander around, and then they show up back at our doorstep, but now they're 27, 28, 29. And so how can we better engage them and make ourselves relevant to their needs? Micropathways is certainly one big opportunity to do that. Mm-hmm. So let me just you know, stop there for now.
So, you know, Ian was answering a question in the chat a few minutes ago, and somebody asked, you know, don't micropathways cannibalize your four credit course offerings, or your, you know, your hope that people are in to a degree program? How do you see it?
Well, it actually, you know, that's, I think, one of the challenges of moving from the first curve to the second curve, right? Mm-hmm. Is that going to cannibalize what you're doing? I think it actually expands, because when you think about it, you're actually focused on a group that you aren't ordinarily serving in a robust way. And so when you look at it from the customer perspective, now we need to do a better job of the new majority learners. That's not cannibalizing away from who we were serving, which was the traditional learner coming out of high school. So we're talking, so it's not, but what it does do, it builds a stronger curriculum that now brings both together. And I think that's one of the positive things about this. So I don't see it as cannibalizing. I see it as expanding our offerings and opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Kathleen, can I add?
Yes,
to that?
I was just going to offer you on the same topic.
Oh, no, Lee, your answer is great. And at Ivy Tech, our associate degree production has remained steady for the last 5 years that I've been here. But the tremendous growth has been in all of our certificates, right, and certifications. And those areas, we went from 21,000 5 years ago to 38,000 completions. Those are high quality, all above median wage kinds of credentials that allow, that's all we can, we take credit for. If they don't earn median wage, we don't count it as a short-term credential, but that's where you see the opportunity with these micro pathways. And now these give us the opportunity to be even more micro, which is meeting that adult learner where they are and allowing them to have the confidence. I agree with Lee, the confidence to go into the next level and the next, instead of this going to school for 4 years or more before you have anything of value. So I think it is just a function. And then I'll say maybe because of my political background as a ex-lieutenant governor, our general assemblies, our legislatures across the country, they're behind micro pathways. They understand that higher education is, they may not call it exactly broke, but they'll say, you know, it's not being bought as it is. So in a red state like ours, this is exactly the right way to go. And I don't think it's just red either. I think it's for all. If you want to be inclusive, this is a way to really be inclusive and to bring all citizens along wherever they are. And I'm just so complimentary of the work that EDL is helping to lead and help to bring us along on, because as Lee, it is a second curve, Lee, I 100% agree. And we have to go into the direction that employers need and citizens need to succeed.
Before we go to Rufus, I'd like to follow up Dr. Elsperman with the question though about, okay, because we talked about these statistics that you were seeing that your degree programs were flat. You had some interesting growth coming from dual enrollment from the high school students, mm-hmm. but your real growth area was in just-in-time learning, in and yes. out, short certificates. But you could have kept doing that as just certificates. What is it about micro pathways that either connects the dots or gives people a more meaningful trajectory to high demand, you know, living wage jobs, yeah. et cetera?
You know, in an environment where talent is in high demand, adults don't have time to even complete that, what we would call a CT, a short-term credential, 18 to 21 hours, we still had our students needing something more immediately. And never was that better expressed than when the pandemic hit and the state approached Ivy Tech to say, can you help us immediately get these unemployed hospitality and other workers into a short-term credential? And we have in Indiana a good set of credentials, not quite micro yet, but we added CDL Plus and some of these made it onto that shorter list, which meant it didn't need federal financial aid. The state was willing to cover it. So there's a willingness by our constituents, our stakeholders, for us to go this way. And it really is just up to us and having people like Stacey Townsley on my team as a designer in residence who can help us show that transition from non-credit to credit to these shorter term credentials, micro pathways, leading into showing that stackability throughout for the long term. And you know, it's on us to do it in a high quality way, because we actually have, if we're not careful, we could mess it up. But if we do it with integrity, and that's where your help is so important, as we do it in a high quality way, it will be natural. It will be like, of course, we should have been doing this all along.
So Dr. Glasper, I want to bring you in. So you were bullish on, you know, Dr. Glasper is on the Education Design Lab's board, and he was bullish from, you know, the 6 months before we had the Seattle meeting, in thinking about how do we help colleges figure this out. And so why, Dr. Glasper, did you feel sure that colleges would respond to this approach of a rapid design process and you know, focused on micro credentials as sort of the entry point for this kind of response to a need for transformation?
Well, first and foremost, Kathleen, I just want to thank everyone for a fantastic day. I am just been sitting back and listening to the growth and the enthusiasm and the passion. And I'm saying it's long overdue. We have an opportunity, and I think it's been described very, very well, to change the curve that we have been on, the trajectory that we have been on, the capsule that we have been in for many years, and to break and support the term that's being used, majority learner. And with the pandemic, the focus was right on those individuals. And there was no answer. And the answer was there, but the answer had been populated in what I would describe as a for-profit community and not necessarily available to those who can afford or should afford a public education. And so they were stressed. We're talking about those who have the family wage, middle class or whatever for a family of four, but they're using these resources to go to an education that can move faster, quicker, and put something in their hands that they believe is usable in today's market. And I think what the approach of the Community College Growth Engine Fund has done is to say that public education through the community colleges can move just as fast, mm-hmm. can bring in their community of which they already own, and can bring in that thinking. However, we were innovative, we had the mindset, but we didn't have the window and the drive because we have these archaic structures that say we must follow lockstep, we must do it by credit hours in this space, we must do it by quality assurance, and that's going to be a big issue in mm-hmm. terms of bringing in the notion of education, moving at the speed of business. And what I think that the model has done with micro pathways and credentials has offered an opportunity for us to redefine what does that mean and redefine it in a way that is inclusive of a partnership with industry and not just have industry sitting around an advisory table. Mm-hmm. So I think if we lose this energy, we're talking about all of the great resignations, and we're talking about the lost generations. This is an opportunity to pull and jumpstart and say, this is a pathway, use it, fund it, embrace it, and move forward. So.
Well, I'd like to pull up a slide that we used earlier today. No, it's not that one. It's the one that shows the different areas that the Community College Growth Engine Fund would be scaling. I think Lisa can find it. This was a snapshot. Yeah, this one exactly. I wanted to just kind of refresh your all's memories with this slide, because what we see happening, and this is what Dr. Lambert and I wrote about in an op-ed piece recently, is that this gateway effect of, you know, you're using the micro pathway to get started, but it actually brings, it starts to build the innovation muscle in so many of these areas. Wanted just to get you all to talk about this and to say, how do we keep that momentum up that Dr. Glasper's talking about? What should come next? Dr. Lambert, you used the term universal design, and that's part of your vision for your innovation framework for the whole system. But how do we, what do you think? What's next for you?
So I always like to talk, you know, big pitch. So part of it is a mindset shift that each of us have to make. And so, you know, we talk about growth mindset and things like that, but what does that really mean unless you're actually doing it, right? And so I look at this and say, okay, what's the approach? We use what we call the four lenses of innovation. So Rowan Gibson wrote this great book called The Four Lenses. And real quickly, they talk about challenging the orthodoxy. So if you're not willing to challenge your status quo, you're not going to get the innovation that leads to a micro pathway. You have to be willing to harness the trends, right? What's going on, and then understand the needs. And I think the ed design approach is really about that human-centered approach, understanding the need of the learner. And that really helps to open this up. And then leveraging your resources, in our case, our partnerships, and in a real meaningful way. I think Rufus touched on this, and so did Sue, where they are actually co-pilots with us. Mm-hmm. They're no longer sitting on an advisory panel. They're actually in there with us designing what they need. And so I think that those are the kinds of things that we're going to take to our liberal arts side of the college. Because I think that's the side for us. That's our first curve. We've got to bring onto the second curve. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we will not be able to sustain ourselves as an organization, because that's where we make the lion's share of our revenue.
Right. So that's part of this artificial separation between credit and non-credit, that you're using micro pathways in part to blend the two types of programs together.
Right. Exactly. Because in my mind, everything we do is about preparing you for a career. And that's all about workforce. Mm-hmm. And one takes you quicker, micro pathways. The other takes you a little longer, liberal arts, to transfer to baccalaureate. In some cases, like many of us on this call, we went on to graduate school, right? Mm-hmm. But in the end, what gets me started? A micro pathway gets me started, especially for, I think, the new majority learners, where they don't have the same time to invest and so forth. So let's get them engaged early on.
But before leaving you on this point, though, we don't want to leave the impression that the stackability, that this short-term pathway is tracking people towards just short vocational programs. I mean, the reason to do it here in this context, rather than a boot camp, is it not, is to have the opportunity to see the entire pathway and the build that you can do towards better and better careers.
That's right. That's why our universal design approach. Mm-hmm. It's already built into the model. So then you can just, you know, build off of that, stack it, and lead it to that certification or that degree, whatever you choose. And I also like the fact, and this is why I think it's important, the integration of the 21st century piece, right? And truth be told, our liberal arts folks need that, because we can't really say to an employer, yeah, this person is a critical thinker, this person's a problem. Well, can we prove it? No, we can't prove that. But this allows us to bring that proof.
Mm-hmm. Sue, did you want to speak to the gateway effect?
Yeah, I'd say all the things that we're doing are great, and we can engage, especially Ivy Tech being a statewide system. I think we have the opportunity to engage partners at a bigger level, not just individual mm-hmm. companies, but whole industries. Whole industry associations across the state. I'll use the example of what we've just done statewide with nursing. Obviously, there's a big, this is not a micro pathway, but it is the example of when you have a huge shortage in workforce, and with a statewide hospital association, we're expanding by 600 RNs in the next 4 years, already the largest program in the country. And how do we do that in building those pathways? So medical assisting to RN, paramedic to RN, but also doing it exactly with that employer group, not single employers, and knowing that they can come to us and we will build the micro pathway they need for their workers. So they're already beginning to talk about what other areas of healthcare can we help build. And that's where, because we've proven ourselves at a big area, traditional area, can we go in at a large scale, at scale? CDL, of course, from what Ivy Tech's done with CDL Plus, that's a great example where it's the whole association, it's the whole need of a state that has large interests in supply chain. And how do we build the credentials that the whole industry needs and have their support, which then gives us the kind of, no one's asking us, are you doing the right thing or not? There's no 2 year or what should you be up to? We're meeting the needs of employers at scale for a state. So I think those partnerships we've been working on for 5 years, they're getting more and more robust where there's trust. that pathway we build, that stackable credential, is aligned to their needs. And to your point, they've been working alongside us throughout this whole time. And I think that's important to change the whole paradigm of higher education. Is it can't be just in our buildings. It has to be the outside world affirming, validating, supporting, and actually driving us to do this, right? Pushing us to do this so that we don't have to argue with the liberal arts side of the house, right? This is just, we, especially community colleges, this is our mission, to scale up a workforce of the future. That is what we do. And if that's a two-year associate's degree, terrific. That's a transfer to a four-year, terrific. But if it's a micro credential, that's what's needed, and that's where we should go.
Well, and isn't it interesting that it's almost like the line is blurring between vo-tech and sort of college type, traditional college work, because everything's becoming more technical and everyone needs, you know, the IT skills, and it really kind of levels that playing field at the same time that you're trying to level the non-credit and credit. I mean, it becomes a pretty false distinction. Is that what you're seeing? I see that with your, yeah. So this is a CDL.
Well, the IT, IT cloud, right? What parent is gonna argue with their son or daughter who wants to get an IT cloud micro-credential, right? Because they know it will stack to something better and better and better, that it is the beginning of a great career. So yes, I believe we have, and we should have always, but we are where we are. So let's stay on that second curve and continue the ride. And it's up to us to make sure we're not messaging any differently to our students, our employers, to our constituents, that these are all of value, and learning is learning, and competencies are competencies. And as that adult learner, that we make it possible for them to get something of value from us in the size they can afford, both in time and resources, and then get a more productive, a better job to see that success. And they can get there just in a different path.
Yeah, I mean, on the flexibility point, I mean, what we're learning is that people, it's not so, they need to either be able to come in and out of their training or do it alongside. And so, your micro pathways are great examples of how people can either do them part-time as a worker on the job, as we heard from Courtenay earlier, who was, you know, the residential construction employer, or that you can do it, you know, part-time or short form, you know, 8 weeks or something, so that the time that you have to take off is then quickly, you know, you're able to get back on a financial track.
The vast majority of that new majority learners we talk about are working adults. Mm-hmm. And we can't ask them to take 8 weeks out or 6 weeks out or 12 weeks out or heaven forbid a year out of their work life. And they are working. So they're getting those professional skills in their job already. So how do we make that an easier path for them? And if they're with an employer, we have many in Indiana, we have several hundred, what we call achieve your degree employers, who've already committed to upfront tuition assistance of those students, of their employees.
Great.
Right. So now they're a real easy ask into these micro credentials, because they've already said yes to helping that employee skill up. So I think this is something that we can do pretty easily, but it is a change in the way we communicate.
So you mentioned affordability, and we did get some questions throughout the afternoon about, okay, well, how do learners pay for these? What do they cost? What do you, you know, if this is going to be a big piece of your offerings in the future, micro pathways that can stack, and most of them start on the non-credit side where you are not compensated, yep. You know, the tuition model is not great. What do you do? How are you gonna sustain the college? I know Dr. Glasper, as the Emeritus Chancellor of Maricopa, you have some strong views about this, and others may too. How do we sustain the new models, if they're better for learners, but probably not better for the institutions financially?
I think you start off with one of your slides by saying that you're proving proof of concept.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You are developing more micro-credentials and micro-pathways than initially planned.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're, I'll make a prediction. And my prediction is that within the next 5 to 7 years, credit and non-credit will have merged.
Hmm.
If the Community College Growth Engine Fund is able to expand, replicate, and scale with the energy level that we have seen on this screen and for the last year, and with the funders and others and businesses coming to the table, then the voice will begin to and continue to rise. I see two colleges here that are in the Higher Learning Commission area of service. I will no longer call it a region because it doesn't have a region. but what I will say is that we have operated out of fear. We've operated and we've used accreditation as a means to stop, and that's within the institution. When faculty did not want to move, when they didn't want to consider the conversation that we're having now, but now we're proving that it can benefit our students. And when we talk about the majority learner, you talk about who's most impacted, we talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion, this is where the numbers are. These are our students. If you can prove and put resources behind it, and the resources are coming from both local and also public industries and some individual student resources, then it has no choice other than to continue to scale. And then students will all continue to come in and out of their workplace and see that a two-year degree and or a four-year degree is viable because of that return on investment. So I'm excited about what's happening here. In 2019, the Higher Learning Commission, and I helped to chair a paper that talked about the unbundling of higher ed. This was in April of 2019. It talked about credentials. And look at where we are today. People are looking for a reason to say that this is valid. And I think that the proof is here. We just need to maintain the energy, continue the funding levels, and exceed the funding levels. And also, we need to do one other thing. The other thing that I would suggest that we do is focus on the whole myth that majority learners cannot learn, majority learners do not want to learn, majority learners like being unemployed, which is a bunch of bull, and everything we're doing is about mythbusters. And it will demonstrate that proof to pudding. The last thing I will say is that the National Science Foundation is promoting a notion of missing millions.
Mm-hmm.
The missing millions fit the same profile that we are talking about now and is focused on trying to get a million individuals that meet the profile to get into undergraduate STEM. The mm-hmm. programs we're talking about are in undergraduate STEM. There's money at the federal level that is unused, untapped, because we don't believe that it undergraduate STEM are the programs that we're offering at our community colleges. Mm-hmm. Bust that myth, impact the missing millions, spend the money, and take a little pressure off of our colleges who are challenged, and think about this notion of, will I succeed or not? Take a path to success and keep moving.
Kathleen, can I
build up? Yeah, go ahead. I was just going to turn to you, actually.
Rufus is hitting on the heart of things that are going to impact our business model.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I applaud him for saying 5 to 7 years. I was thinking it'd be by the end of this decade. So we're probably closely aligned in that regard. But that notion of proof of concept is powerful. And so when I sat down with one of our business leaders to talk about what we're doing in micropathways, and I talked about in the non-credit side. I said, I need your support. If you provide the funding, this, and he's given us 2 years of funding for a specific area, that we're going to get the data we need to go make that proof of concept argument. So I think that's one, and I know data is one of the key elements of the design. And I think that's going to be critical. So what the work we're all doing is going to be essential to what Rufus was making the point about. But I'll say the other thing, it's how we have the conversation with our employers. Sitting down recently with a group of employers, instead of saying credit versus non-credit, you start the conversation about what is it that they need, and they start describing to you what that is. And then you quickly realize that we're talking about skills and competencies, not credit and non-credit. And then you ask them at some point, and I did this, do you care? They don't care. This is what they need, right? So I think training our educators to know how to have that dialogue, because we quickly go to this dichotomy, credit, and it kills the conversation. So let's flip it around. And I think the work we've done with you and your team is going to help a lot in doing and moving to what Rufus is talking about. And then that's how we get to the sustainability on our business models.
And is there any reason why we can't take these STEM feeder programs, because we're working with designing those with some community colleges, why can't those become a piece of micro pathways, right? We don't have to, these are not just, they're role specific, but when you think about how they stack to other roles, the traditional, whether it's engineering or, hard sciences or nursing, those can be in the later parts of the stacks, right? It's not, we're not just trying to track people in and out. I just want to make that really clear. I mean, that's not your intention either, I know, but, I think when people first look at micro pathways, that's the question, is this tracking?
Well, and if we're going to be innovating at the speed of business, many times we need to start on the non-credit side, right? I think about the smart manufacturing, the Internet of Things, Industry 4.0, those SOCA certifications came first. Right. And then we built out the associate degree, right? So this, if we're going to be, whether it's AI, cloud, other, whatever the next new technology is, we really need to start with a micro pathways approach and build up to, rather than waiting 4 or 5 years so we can figure out what a full 2 or 4 year degree would look like. Mm-hmm. So I think this just becomes a part of how we co-create what industry needs in real time.
Mm-hmm. So I wanted to end on a question around, first of all, I want to mention the data piece. We are, because this hasn't really come up today, we didn't have any presentations on it because it is, it's new, but we are creating a data collaborative among the colleges to basically track what happens to learners who go through these micro pathways. We're also working with the Urban Institute on a on two evaluations. So we are trying to get really clear on the quality, and a continuous feedback loop, because that's really missing in the field as well. We don't know, on the non-credit side, we don't know what happens to learners because they're not really getting tracked, right? They're not, because they're not getting federal financial aid. So I wanted to end with each of you saying something about where, because we'd like to continue, even though your design year is coming to an end, we'd like to continue the work, and we want to scale the model because we have lots of people asking us for it. And the question is, how do you do this at scale, beyond the 24 colleges that we have now with the two cohorts? Where would you like to take this work at your institutions? We'll start with you, Lee.
Well, so fortunately for us, and Rufus was a big part of this when he was chancellor at Maricopa, the 10 colleges, we have gotten together, our 10 districts, and we're working better together now. And so that we can take an idea from any one district and really start to scale it to the other districts. So I see, we've done this in the advanced manufacturing side. I see us doing a similar thing here. Pima might have been the genesis for our state for this. We can now work with Maricopa because they're now going to be a partner in this. Mm-hmm. And then we all work together, and then we get it to all of our 10 districts in the state. And of course, Indiana already has the advantage. Sue has the advantage on all of us, but she has the right model, right? for us to really think about. And if we start to do it that way, we hit all states. So if Shouan could take it to the, I used to be in as part of the Washington State system for all of you who may not know my background. So if he can take it to the 34 colleges, then we get Washington State, right? I think that's how we're gonna get there. And the folks at Prince George taking it there in Maryland, and all of a sudden we're gonna be scaling a lot faster than we realize if we can really get that buy-in at the state. And that's what my plan is.
Get okay, great. And a quick follow-up before we go to Dr. Elsperman on this. We have 144 micro-credentials and 30 pathways now. Do you think these will be or can be adopted in a way that employers, you know, don't have to get confused about this, you know, the sea of new short-term credentials? Is that a pipe dream? Or in other words, that everyone's going to want to create their own? In other words, will there be some common, we're getting to some common frameworks. That's great by industry and 21st century skills. I think that's going pretty well. But do you think that we'll be able to use the credentials that are at the end of micro pathways across states?
I would sure hope we get there. It's something we should aspire to, and we should. And again, this kind of work puts us in position to do that in a non-required way, but one where those early adopters can come on board. So I hope that should certainly be something we aspire to do together because it's good for all. And then I was nudged by our team here to say, we've still got to your question about where do we go next, Kathleen. We have more work to do inside our institution in how we all understand credit and non-credit, and that non-credit can happen at the same time as credit, and that those are not two different things. And so while I think parts of our organization have really bought in to micro-credentials, micro-pathways, I don't think we haven't yet communicated that throughout and made it comfortable for everyone to understand how this moves forward and how it builds a more resilient model of community college, one that is truly walking alongside industry and students and our communities to be successful. So I think that's going to be a very interesting, and Rufus, I sure hope we can beat your timeline on when we get there, because we're going to be pushing it, I promise you.
Yeah.
Rufus, do you want to take us home on this?
Yeah, what I would like to do is to say that I'm still in Arizona. I'm still involved with the Higher Learning Commission. And the Higher Learning Commission is looking at this notion right now regarding what's a credential? What does accreditation mean? Offered by a regional accreditor or any other organization such as NCCER, and how valid is it? And once it's valid, is it portable? So as we start checking some of these, I think earlier about whether or not these micro-credentials or micro-pathways will be portable. Will they be accepted by other colleges? We need to consider everything that is happening within these six colleges now, and the four and the others around the country that are coming on board as being open source, and encouraging people and sharing the information. Why should we want to hold it close to our chest? And if we do that, we can make the journey easier for others across the nation. And I'll close by saying the league is a platform. It is a national platform. We do webinars. We gladly host it in an education design lab. We'll host any of the colleges that want to come on board and just talk about what their journeys are. Keep the voices out there, make them loud, make them repetitive, and engage people, and show that it is sustainable. Sustainability is the question, but it's also the answer. And this is a strong possibility. And with that, just a great day. Thank you for the opportunity to voice an opinion. mm-hmm. and to be a part of this future success. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And we do have one question from the chat. We were going to take questions, but I think people have been asking questions all day, but there's one specific for this panel, which is, it's sort of directed to Rufus, but I think anyone could answer it. It's really about, okay, it relates back to the very first charge that I mentioned at the beginning of the day, which is, can community colleges be the talent broker, regional talent broker between new majority learners and employers? And it really asks the question, you know, why, you know, what's going to be the value proposition? Why are community colleges going to be able to compete on this, in this role in the future and win out over, you know, I imagine the question doesn't ask this, but I imagine it's over, you know, external competitors like boot camps or even, you know, even four-year colleges or other folks that come into the field, because there's a lot of money. There's a lot of, you know, for-profit companies getting started in workforce training right now, billions of dollars coming into the market.
I would start with just it's an affordable model.
Mm-hmm.
Affordability.
That's affordability typically grounded in state and local government, where there's some funding streams, unlike these ones that will bubble for a while, they'll come and they'll go. We have a commitment from our stakeholders to understanding why we're here. And as long as we live true to our mission of being that workforce engine in our communities and our states, I think we have a bright future.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Lambert?
And I would say, to add on top of all of that, we have the airplane. We have the car. We have all of the physical things at some point someone's going to need to come and actually be able to do the work on. Mm-hmm. And so if you can't apply what you've learned virtually, then it really it's not going to have value in the marketplace, right? I think that's our greatest strength, is we actually have a physical presence with strong brands almost in many communities across the country. If we take advantage of all this other stuff, move to the second curve, I think we become unbeatable.
I feel like you have learner trust, but what you need to build in part in this process is employer trust, right? To be that partner. Well, this has been exciting. Thank you so much for this. Has been a really fun panel and a great way to, you know, sort of voice the ideas that we've been talking about the whole time. So let me thank Dr. Elsperman, Dr. Lambert, and Dr. Glasper for your vision and your support for this process. From the inception in March of 2020, but also even before that. So thank you for closing us out today. And with that, I'm turning it back over to Dr. Larson.
Great. Thanks, Kathleen. And thank you to a wonderful panel, Chancellor Lambert, President Elsperman, Dr. Glasper. It really was so refreshing. And as a recent college president and passionate educator, I so appreciate your insights and your visions, your myth breaking, the courageous risk taking, like changing our language, the credit or non-credit. It's really about learner experiences and meeting these new majority learners where they are and building experiences on where they are and what they know to career opportunities in these in-demand, high-wage careers in critical sectors through micro-pathway development. So I so appreciate and thank you for sharing your innovations leading to transformation. And we look forward to a stronger future because of each of you helping with this work. So what's next for the fund? We're continuing to build resources, information, data about the fund's partners' work to date, such as our insights brief. We will also be sharing blogs and other writings on both Cohort 1 and 2 colleges, their experiences, what they're achieving, the trails they'll be blazing. We will also soon begin design sessions around scaling and adopting and activating this work in other ways. And our president's forums will continue around such topics around impact and transformation. So the Community College Growth Engine Fund's micro pathway initiatives have demonstrated community colleges' recognition of new majority learners, deep investment in critical regional employers, and ability to drive great changes within their institutions. Our Cohort 1 colleges are true barrier breakers and models for Cohort 2, The next year, we will continue to be informed and to answer the question, are micro pathways the gateway to community college transformation? We want to thank you today for being with us. We want to ask you to stay tuned, stay engaged, and stay in touch. We're happy that you joined us, and we want to ask you to make sure that you visit our website often for important resources and updates. Check us out on Twitter and LinkedIn, and feel free to email us at ccgef@eddesignlab.org. Thanks again. You inspire us. Our colleges inspire us to do the work that we do. And we couldn't thank you more for you spending time with us today. Take care. Have a great day.